let's go into dumbassery number two. Is does lower, if you're trying to build up a location, well, I'm only at 200 active right now, we want it to be 300, so we're going to charge a low price point to fill up the school, and then we'll start inching it up. Does that statement make sense?
No.
That statement doesn't make any sense. You know why that doesn't make any sense? Is your intro flow has nothing to do with what you're charging, right? So the number of people who raise their hand, the leads, the only thing it has anything to do with is what the introductory offer is and where you're promoting it and, you know, what the bait is to bring them in, if you want to use that term. But the actual price point of the tuition has nothing to do with how many people walk through your front doors, right? Then,
and in a sense, in your close rate.
Well, I was going to say, that's the next thing, right? So it has nothing to do with how many people come in. And if anything, raising the prices improves rather than diminishing the close rate. Now, anchor that for a second. It's either a neutral impact or it improves the close rate, right? And it's certainly within a certain bound, right? I mean, it certainly is possible that if your tuition was $247 a month versus $35 a month, you're going to price fewer people out at $35 a month. So that is, you know, it is indisputably true. However, for all of the people who can afford it, if you presented the $35 a month, month to month, all the people like me would go somewhere else because they wanted a good school, right? So what trying to be cheap does is it self-select, and you end up with a school full of the students you didn't want, and you actually repel all the ones you did want. Okay, and not intentionally, but subconsciously. Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. So the pricing, you know, the dumbassery, I love that. The dumbassery of the pricing deal is people think, and this is, you know, economics 101, is price elasticity relative to demand. Gasoline prices have a price versus demand elasticity because it's a commodity, right? Price of a barrel of oil is a commodity. There's a price demand elasticity that goes like this. Does everybody know that? Oil prices go up, demand goes down. The more oil prices go up, the more people switch to natural gas. The more they switch to renewables, one thing or another, the more it goes down, the more they buy SUVs, right? Is, you know, why be in the car business would be hard. Oil prices spiked, Hummer goes out of business. GM kills a bunch of their SUVs. Oil prices go down, all the small cars, they can't give them away now. You know, I mean, you could buy an Escalade at one time for like, you know, 30 grand because they were trying to just get rid of them, right? And now you're on back order and all that stuff again. So it's, but we're not in that business, right?
Well, and that's wrong for how that relates to competition. Yeah. Is if you're driving around and there's gas stations, you might pull into the gas station that has the 10-cent cheaper gas, right? You know, we all might do that. We might make that decision. I'm going to pull into the gas station that's a little bit cheaper gas. I personally don't actually do that. I always buy the Chevron or Shell. That's the only gas I have in my car because I actually care about it. But most people, it matters to them. So that kind of commodity or that type of product, competition might make a difference. You might pay attention. The dumbassery I hear all the time is, well, you know, I wanted to price myself so I'm right in the middle. Think about that. That's the absolute stupidest thing you could do. The absolute stupidest thing you could do. Because if price mattered, nobody would sign up with you because there's cheaper people, right? So if price mattered, that would be stupid. And if price didn't matter, it would be stupid because why would you price lower than the other guys?
Who in here is now for leadership charging double or more what your new enrollment price is? Double or more. So stand up. Double or more. Okay. Who's at least 50% more?
Ooh. Really?
Okay. Okay, good. Sit down. So here's where I think you should be minimal.
To be clear, everybody who didn't stand up, you're charging less than 50% more for your leadership program, yes?
Or doesn't have one. Who doesn't have a real upgrade? And we'll give you a pass, you're new. Okay, so, but here's what, you take your new enrollment tuition, right, is at the very least, and now write that down, at the least, your leadership program should be doubled. And then you have a fallback that's around 50% bump. Okay? So if you're at 197 now for a new enrollment, let's say that's at least 397. Right? Now, the other thing is, by the way, when you bump a price, see, again, a dumbassery thing to do would be is be at 405. Okay? Once you pop a threshold, you know, be significant. Because psychologically, it doesn't make any difference in the presentation. Right? There's a bigger difference between them psychologically between 397 and 405 than there is between 405, 427, and 447. Does everybody logically get that? Mm-hmm. Right? So once you pop a threshold, you know, go on up a little bit more, right? Amanda, you were doing that, weren't you? I mean, you were like 503 or something rather than...
Like 508, which is just...
Yeah, know, it should be 547.
It's
yeah.
497.
Okay. Yeah. So with the enrollments, you know, our rule of thumb is the leadership should be at least double. Now let me tell you what some evidence based for that. In almost all cases where we have the enrollment price, then we have the leadership at double. We're getting somewhere between 75 and 90% of the people who renew go into the more expensive option. Okay? Amanda, what are you running right now in the leadership?
You mean versus the...
Versus Master Club.
Master Club. About 75, probably more like 85%.
85%. So let's say 85%. Sterling's numbers forever was 92%, I believe. Alan, what are you running on the higher program?
75.
About 75%. Yeah. Okay. So... Now,
is it conversion into leadership versus Master Club?
Right. Okay. Versus the fallback. Right. Now, that's a good question. Right. Is what I would say your minimum threshold should be is I do enrollments. Right. So let's say that I do an average of 20 enrollments a month. I want to convert at least 75% of them into the upgrade.
Into the leadership upgrade,
into some upgrade. Okay. Now notice I said at least. Okay. Everything I'm saying is at least. In other words, if you're below that, it's problematic. Okay. So at least 75% of them I want to upgrade. Right. Now I designed this whole thing with the expectation of it looking like this. We're going to price it high enough that we priced half of them out of being able to do it, right? The actual outcome for years has been 75 to 90% doing the more expensive option. What does that mean? The more expensive option isn't expensive enough. Did everybody get that? Right? Because if you have the high option and then you have a fallback, and hardly anybody ever does the fallback, what does that mean?
You can raise it.
You can push it. Does that make sense to everybody? Right?
Could you break that down a little bit further even? Just mainly for my staff, I'm trying to get them on the track of expectations for the renewal process as that percentage. So if we're saying 75% renew minimum.
Right.
Can you break that down in a time frame for that first year enrollment? So month. How many percent in the first 3 months? How many percent in the second?
Absolutely. Think of it this way, right? So here is, in all of you are going to be a little bit different, right? You know, I know there's some crowd people who think that there's one superhuman being who is, you know, is only hurt by kryptonite, is the only black belt that's ever lived in the world, and has graced our presence. And some of the Brazilian jiu-jitsu, right? I mean, but then some of the Brazilian jiu-jitsu guys, you know, are like 12-year black belts and stuff like that. But just, you know, put that on pause for a second as I describe this. But let's say that black belt is 3 to 4 years. And let's say that second degree is 2 to 3 years after that as a frame of reference, right? So if this were black belt, and this is second degree, and this is third degree. So let's say that's 4 years and that's 2 years for argument. Does that make sense? Okay. Then what we're doing is a trial enrollment, which is about a quarter of the way to black belt initially to get started. I mean, and that's the language, right? So, and then let's say that belt one is in 2 months and belt two is in 2 months. So let's say it's just 2 months testing cycle. Again, all of you are going to be a little bit different. But our benchmark has always been 50% at least of everybody who enrolls is renewed by the first belt, which equals 2 months.
Somewhere in that 2 months, not at the belt testing or something.
Right.
So it doesn't mean wait till the testing and try to upgrade everybody. You've been working on them all the whole 2 months. By the way, that also helps your customer service. None of this stuff is only selling. You're doing a really good job of helping them get acclimated to your program and everything else. But
well, go back to the enlightened self-interest thing. If I sit down and say to somebody, I mean, pick any of the benefits that we're pitching, but if I say you're going to receive such incredible confidence that you're going to be confident in all situations, and for a child, you know, Joey's going to be an A student, immune to negative peer pressure. If Joey drops out right here, did he accomplish those things?
No.
No. What happens in almost all martial arts schools? They make these really nice sounding promises, which are by definition a lie. Why are they lying to all their prospects?
Because they never stay around long enough.
They don't stay around long enough to get there, right? So if almost everybody in a school drops out in 3 to 6 months, they're not going to accomplish much other than have been entertained for a while, right? They really have to be here to here to here to here to have total unshakable confidence and to be able to defend themselves and all that stuff that we promise them.
Just a quick question. When you say they're renewed, you're meaning the upgrade.
Right. I have a bad habit of using the word renew and upgrade as interchangeable.
I just wanted to make sure I understood.
Well, but let me tell you why it's a bad habit. Renew in this context is the idea of setting the goal and making the commitment. Upgrade in this context is two things. One, a higher level of service. Two, and an elevated price point. Okay? Think about what upgrade means on an airline. An upgrade is you go from coach to first class, right? An upgrade at the rail car place is you go from the, you know, little Econo box to you go to a full-size sedan, or they give you a Corvette or something. So upgrade means a higher level of service, really. Renewal means making a longer commitment and setting a longer goal. My bad habit is I use those two words interchangeably, because in our context, every renewal we do is going to be an upgrade with both a higher level of service and a higher price point. Does that make sense? Okay. But that's good clarification. So going back to what Greg asked, benchmark number one would be at least half of everybody who enrolls ends up renewed in the first couple of months before their first belt. And as Master Moody said, that doesn't mean you know, you're scrambling the week before the test to now start talking to everybody about the renewal. That starts with the first introductory class, really. But for some of them, that final deadline for the price point is going to be at the test. Okay? And then 50% of everybody who's left. In other words, if I'm enrolling an average of 20 people a month, that means that 10 of them renewed before bell test number one, at least. In other words, at least 50%, right? And then of the 10 that haven't, at least another half of them, so five, renew by the second test, so by the fourth month. Does that make sense, Greg? So and that would mean that by the fourth month, at least 75%. Okay? Now, in the best I've ever seen on that was the Sterling School back when Master Smith was running at Folk Hill. And his numbers were 87% of everybody who enrolled ended up renewed almost all by the second belt, and his numbers were 90% of them ended up in leadership. In fact, the number ended up being 100%, and I kept beating on him with, "What? Why are you only charging $397? It should be $597." But
with the idea that that would change the close rate, but it probably wouldn't.
Probably not, but then we can keep inching it up.
You get a clarification when you ask the question of what rate we're charging.
Right.
We have what I guess I'll call a book rate of $397 for the leadership program.
Okay.
But we're offering deals to get them to do it at white belts, at yellow belts, at orange belts.
Yeah.
So is that where we, is that normal? I mean, are we not doing it right by offering them, you know, if they do the white belt renewal, they can do it. If they do it now and it's at $297 instead of $397?
Here's
that when you ask me what I'm charging, I tend to answer in my mind with what I'm charging, not necessarily what the sticker price is.
Exactly right. I would be on exactly the same page on that.
Okay.
Okay. And so let me answer that question. This, I think, was, I always like to get credit where it's due. I try not to take credit for anything that I didn't actually think of. An awful lot of this renewal upgrade stuff was created by Jeff Smith, going all the way back to the Jim Rea Institute in the, you know, 35 years ago. So almost anywhere you saw it anywhere, that's where it originated. But the price structure thing, I think, was John Morley, who was a former June Rea guy who did the Diamond Nationals, which before that was the Mid-America. And they had, at one time, I think there was 13 or 15 Mid-America schools, and then they split into USA Karate and National Karate, and then National Karate ended up being like 13 locations by itself. The other half was Padua. But I think that's where this originated, and I stole it like 30 years ago. But price point, and again, I know everybody has like different belt levels and stuff, but we have a white belt tuition level, a gold belt, an orange plus, and then a standard. And what nothing magical about the standard, but the standard number is you enroll for 12 months, you wait 12 months, you renew.
Right.
Right? Now, in practical terms, we hardly ever renew anybody at that, because if they haven't renewed down here, they're probably never going to, right? But so if this number were $597 a month, right? It could be that this is $497. It could be that this was $447, and it could be that this was $397. And then in doing the price presentation, what I would always do is, let's say it's a 48 month. In practical terms, we're doing longer than that, but let's say it's 48 months.
So this is a $50 times 48 months difference. And this is a versus $100, but this is 200 times 48 months, right? So in the presentation, I would say, now, you know, Ms. Jones, the reality is essentially everybody who gets to black belt makes a decision when they're white belt that they're either going to really commit to this or not. Given that that's the case, and given that we really want you to encourage you to sit down, go through, evaluate, and make a firm decision, there's about a $10,000 savings for making the decision now. Okay? Well, can't I wait and do it later? Sure, I just hate to see you pay that much more.
Yeah, and we're not presenting these four prices.
No.
One, that's too complicated.
We're presenting this versus this.
Right. They don't even, and if they say, well, I'll wait till they're an orange belt, we never say, well, okay, it's only $50 more than.
Right. Yeah.
But we never, ever say that. You always just say, well, okay, you know, I mean, you know, then we know to put them back in the system.
Yep.
To try to keep working them to enroll earlier.
Well, and actually what happens a lot of times is it then brings out not an objection but a condition, right? You know, Tom Hopkins defines it as a condition is something that they can't change, you can't change, and an objection is something that they're just, you know, resisting, need more information, need more clarity, right?
And I
whole bunch of questions, so go ahead.
I just would you repeat what you said to her, Mrs. White?
Yeah. Wait, which part?
You're recording this, by the way, so you
can't.
Okay.
I'm happy to. Rewind. Okay, so, you know, Ms. White, which part?
You make a decision when you're over
there.
I
think
the
reality.
Oh, yeah.
The reality is.
Yeah.
That's okay.
I always talk to Mrs. Jones, not Mrs. White. But, you're throwing off my role play, Nora. But so Mrs. White, Mr. and Mrs., because I'm not going to ever just talk to Mom, because even though she says she can make all the decisions, she's lying to me. Okay, she doesn't know she's lying to me yet, but she's lying to me. Okay, or he's lying to me, right? Dad says, "Oh, I'm going to make all the financial decisions. Just tell me." Like it. But, you know, Ms. Jones, what we have found is essentially everyone who gets to their black belt, make a decision, really set the goal, go through the goal setting process, go through the decision making process at white belt. And if they really make a firm commitment and decision to be a black belt, they're going to be a black belt. And by the way, as an aside, this isn't the role play. I've tracked the numbers, and that's absolutely a true statement, right? The ones who set the goal, renew the leadership early on, the only way they drop out is they get moved to New Delhi or they have some traumatic injury. I mean, the dropout rate plummets, right? So I'm not lying to them. You know, I'm not exaggerating. I'm not trying, right? Telling them the truth, which by the way, is sales rule number one. Always tell the truth. Sometimes you want to edit how much volume of information you're downloading on them, but you never want to exaggerate, equivocate, or certainly lie to somebody to make a sale, because that's going to screw up the relationship, right? Sooner or later, they're always going to figure out that you didn't tell them an accurate. Ms. White, think about it this way, is you have preschool, kindergarten, elementary, middle, high school, on to Harvard, West Point, whatever it might be, college, maybe mm-hmm. graduate school, doctor, lawyer, whatever you have. You have academics. Sadly, in most cases, most schools are teaching reading, writing, and arithmetic. They're really not teaching character. Mm-hmm. And they're really not teaching discipline and focus. And what the martial arts school is all about is about teaching discipline, focus, character, the ability to get along well with people, but be immune to negative peer pressure, seek out positive peers. It's teaching the ability to be self-motivated, to set goals and achieve those goals, and to really focus and do well in school, but really to do well in every aspect of life as well. And then there's always going to be a variety of seasonal recreational activities. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Every black belt we've ever had, one of our black belts was the best baseball player in the state in high school. Another one was the top track star, in high school. So all of our black belts, through the process, have done soccer, hockey, baseball, some at a very high level, competitive level. Right, and in fact, I'll freely admit that some of those who, maybe were the best baseball player in the state, there were times that their training with us was a little bit less intense, and times it was a little bit more intense because mm-hmm. they had to juggle scheduling a little bit. Mm-hmm. But the martial arts program is an ongoing program, just like school. Mm-hmm. Okay, and these other things are seasonal recreational activities.
Mm-hmm. And I've gotten that too, or somebody says, well, yeah, but school is mandatory and this is optional, and that just goes back to what you were previously saying, right? It's not enough.
So Mrs. Jones, would you let your 8-year-old drop out of elementary school and never learn to read or do addition if you had an opportunity to do that?
Right.
Well, of course not. Well, and truthfully, in today's world, education is even more important, right? Mm-hmm. 100 years ago, having a high school education might not be that important. Nowadays, having a college education is getting pretty important. So, mm-hmm. I'm sure you wouldn't, even if it wasn't legally mandated, I'm sure you wouldn't not have your child be in elementary, middle, high school, and so forth.
Right.
So we have a good percentage of new students coming in that are the 3 to 6-year-olds. And do you phrase any of this differently for these?
No.
Really?
Mm-hmm. And that's, we still have like 4 questions from the first round of role play, including David. But that was something else that came up with Master Smith going around to the different schools, is he found several people who weren't, whatever it is, little ninjas or whatever, with the 3, 4, 5-year-olds not renewing them into leadership or Black Belt Club or whatever. Is anybody not doing that? But why?
Yeah, so our close rate in the leadership
is higher.
For that group is much higher. It's almost 100% for that group.
And by the way, if I have a kindergartner, does this resonate better or worse?
Better.
Right? No, absolutely.
Yeah, so parents in that age group also are thinking about, they're the ones that buy the little Einstein things, they're the ones that think about development. In elementary school, I feel like they've abdicated their responsibility, in many ways they have, to the school. But before elementary school, in the preschool age group, which we're talking about, they're very involved in like, I need to do something to get my kid ready, I need to do something to get my kid excited. So think about that, but you should just do that immediately, like tomorrow.
Yeah, make sure, it doesn't matter if they're 3, 4, or whatever, that you're doing the same renewal process with them.
And we start at 3 if they're ready. Yeah. So, that if you're not working with that group, you're missing out.
Is anybody doing a different price point for the younger kids?
Well, that's stupid, too.
Yeah, don't do that.
Yeah.
You're working harder on those little kids.
Yeah. And sometimes the argument is, well, the, the little kids' class, like ours, is 30 minutes, and the bigger kids' class, for the basic class, we just do 30 for both of them. But as we upgrade them, that class stays at 30 minutes. Well, yeah, but it's 30 minutes, but we're never selling time. We're never selling time, ever.
That's another dumbassery point.
That's another dumbassery point, absolutely. Time meaning longer classes or more classes per week. Stupid. That's not what you sell. That's not what you should be offering. That's not a selling point in most cases.
If they're 3-4 whatever, renew them the same as you would renew everybody else. Have the same commitment levels as you would everybody else. They think it's easier. Yes, sir.
I don't have the 3-4-5 program, but I get a lot of inquiries about it, and I just haven't been able to hash out how to structure it. So outside of this time, could someone pull me to the side?
We can talk about it as a group. Who else has some questions about that?
Well, I think it's relevant in terms of, you know, my point of view. You start everything, we were talking about this the other night, with the adult program online. What are my adults doing?
Yeah.
And we want our adult program to be strong and be a hard physical class. And then what is the change when they go to kids? To me, it's just teaching less or teaching the same amount, but maybe they learn it over a longer period of time. It doesn't mean they test less frequently, they test the same frequency. But the delivery is a little different. And then for the little kids, in our case, we just lop it in half. You know, whatever the adults are, and they do half of it, they test more frequently. We just have just intermediate belts. But and then they, with the little kids, everything we do is with the leader. So if you can do it without a leader, that's great. You're in the Karate Kids class. So then the Tiny Tigers class, the Little Ninjas class, whatever you call it, becomes a precursor to jump. What we wanted to do is eventually get them into the regular
mainstream
class.
Them into the regular
class. But sometimes, you know, if you're starting at 3 years old, maybe they take a long time to do that. That's totally fine.
And
when they go in there, they're ready.
Is the leader a kid from an older class, or is it, I mean,
are no, they, there's no leader. What do you mean?
I don't know. I mean, they're always with the leader.
One thing that I do, it may be a little different, is one of my rules is the little kids' classes, they only have one instructor because they're not old enough to know who to watch. So give me 50 kids, I don't care, 3-year-old, 50 kids, I'll take them. So if you, and we were talking the other night about, you know, there's certain people that, they say they have a Tiny Tigers instructor, a Little Ninjas instructor. I don't have any of that. All our guys can do all of them. If the curriculum's designed right, it's not that hard to teach them.
Let's cycle back to that, though. Okay.
Yeah.
So,
but some general rules.
We still have it. There was a hand back here somewhere earlier. Yes, sir.
I was just curious how you structure. Like, I have 4.5-year-olds and 5-year-old students, and they're some of my best students, and they pay the same price as the 8-year-olds and the adults. But then I've had 3-year-olds inquire, and I've had some 4-year-olds that I've done intro lessons for, and I'm like, their coordination level is at like a 3-year-old, and they would really disrupt the class. So I thought about adding like a less coordinated 3 to some 4.5
sure.
aren't as coordinated separate times.
He says
but
yes, I say no.
But I was just curious, I guess, how would you still do the same amount of time for the class? Like, I'd be 45-minute classes. And
with the preschool
well,
kids.
Well, I'm not sure we understand what he's saying. Do you have like a 3-4-5-year-old class?
So I have a 4 to 7-year-old range, and I have like a 7 to 12-year-old range class. So I split it based on coordination, really, at the 6 and 7-year-old age. Some 6-year-olds are coordinated enough to be with the older group. So
well, I would say it differently.
Sure.
Is again, whatever you want to call it. You know, Little Ninjas is the NAPA trademark for the little kids. But what I see people, again, dumbassery number 0.7, is I see some people advocating you have a class for the 3-4-5-year-olds. Then you have a class for the 6-7-year-olds.
Oh, it's worse. That one we're talking about is like 3 and 4, 5 and 6,
yeah.
7 and 8, 9 and 10, 11 and 12. That's the dumbest thing you can do.
Yeah, don't do that. Only think of the youngest level class is there to get them where they can mainstream into the regular class,
sure.
Right? And if that takes them a month, or if that takes them 6 months, whatever it takes in order for them to have learned enough to be capable of being in the regular class, and again, to learn in the regular class and not be disruptive in the regular class, because both are an issue, right? Then you mainstream them into that regular class. we've always had it where some of them are in that class for a couple weeks, then they're in the regular class, plus they're doing some supplemental, and then they're just in the regular class, right? Is so the ones that you perceive to be less coordinated, I think more in terms of attention span.
Yeah.
But the ones that you perceive to be less coordinated, less attention span, that's just to get them to the point that you can move them into the other class, right? And so when you're trying to implement like a 3, 4, 5 year old, whatever, really it's you have the same curriculum, you just stretch it out a little bit more. Because you want it to be parallel so that when they're ready to move, they're moving into the same thing in the same way, everything else, right?
And we synchronize it too. So if they move in the middle of a testing cycle, doesn't matter.
Yeah.
I mean, or sometimes there's the scenario where you've got a 4-year-old and a 7-year-old, and the mom can only bring, you know, the 4-year-old, and they can one day a week they have to bring him to the same class. Mm-hmm. So that maybe they go to the same class, and the other time they bring him to the two separate classes. And we work at, but I think a key point of this is, and we talked about this when I was getting my master's degree in psychology, that people think so much about chronological age. Chronological age is this big, you know, bell curves, right? Well, chronological age is like this big, wide, flat bell curve. It's like a 3-year-old could be just as smart and coordinated as a 9-year-old, and there's 9-year-olds that are as coordinated or have the attention span of a 2-year-old or a 3-year-old. So think about these programs as ability groupings, not age groupings.
Right.
You get so caught up. Now, in your marketing, you're going to say, we take kids, you know, as young as 6 years old, or we have whatever you're going to do to make sure people know that you're going to work with those that age kid. But your program should be ability groupings, not age. Because you might have a 7-year-old that's better to start out in the other program because he's got Down syndrome. You know, so I've started him out in the Tiny Tigers program, or the Little Ninjas program. And then we'll move him if we can move him. I mean, he may stay there for a long time. And then there may be a 5-year-old, and a lot of times it's because their brother is 6 or their brother is 7 or 8, that we just start them out right in the older kids program. You know, so when we do our introductory lesson, that's an important part about that. We're getting them acclimated, we're evaluating them. And I kill my guys if they stick a kid in my class that shouldn't be there. You know, if they're not able to handle it, but we rarely get that because of how we structure it. Now, I would say one thing about chronological age. There's all this like, well, when is the Tiny Tigers or the Little Ninjas program start? Typically, if you look at Piaget, which is the founder of developmental psychology, you know, 3 to 6, so up till 6, below 3 is a different grouping. And if anybody wants us to help them with, in my opinion, below 3 years old, and like one of those things where they have the moms jumping around with their kid in the, what do you call it, the thing. There's somebody advertising for that right now. They're saying, oh, do this program. That's just, I have nothing to do with that. I don't even want to talk about it. I think that's not really, you're not teaching them martial arts. It's kind of a weird thing anyway.
It's a mom and child bonding experience.
Yeah, I personally don't want anything to do with that. But I guess we can help you market. I don't know.
Nick Coquinas used to call it the WEP class.
Yeah, right. Yeah. But that, so think about that in terms
the
of the
class
way,
and then the Pee-wee class.
Right, yeah. Right. The way that you're structuring that ability grouping, typically 3 to 6. So in other words, elementary school, preschool, and then ability groupings. And you know, that's the way it is in school too. Yeah. If they're not ready for first grade or kindergarten, they don't go to kindergarten until the next year sometimes. There's kids on the edge, right? You guys want to get away from that chronological thinking. You have more flexibility than a school. Because in a school, they get in big trouble if you don't start a kid till in kindergarten until they're 10.
Yeah, but, and we still have like 6 questions.
That's wrong. I was just, maybe we ought to go through and list all the topics and things and then come and start hitting them so that we can keep organizing.
Absolutely.
Because otherwise we're jumping around so much. Not because you guys, you have great questions.
But let's go back to that first statement is, I always recommend.
You get to everybody.
What?
I was telling Ms. Boston to get to everybody because she's been having her hand up a bunch of times. But everybody has. They're really good questions.
Yeah, absolutely. There clearly are some people in the room here that are doing predominantly or exclusively adult programs. Who is that? Okay. So this doesn't apply.
Well, but I like the discussion because we've had kids programs. I'd like to reintroduce it, but I need to know how to do it.
Okay.
Well, and I would say one other thing on it in terms of how you're handling the little kids, middle kids, big kids. If you look nationally, and I've done nationally on databases I've had access to, that if you look at when people sign up, in almost all cases in most schools that I looked at, 40% of the market, in schools that had kids, they didn't look at schools that were predominantly adults, 40% of the market people signed up in the 3 to 6 year old age range. 40% was 7 to 12, and 20% was 13 and
13 up.
Yeah, so if you think about it, if you're not really doing much with that, or your signups for the below sevens are like 10% of your market, you're missing a whole bunch of market share.
Right.
And if you have the program anyway, it's just dumb not to. They're really easy to market to. They're really good.
Yeah, but where I was going with that is if you have kids, I would never have a kids class. It would always be family class, adult class, and the whatever you want to call it, let's say little ninjas, but the get me ready for family class.
By the way, we took your suggestion on that, and we did a family class instead of having a youth class, and it worked a lot better.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. So, but what happens is then, if you know, let's say that I was doing predominant marketing for kids. Well, the way that I can go from 20 enrollments a month to 30 enrollments a month overnight with no additional effort, no additional cost, is start adding mom and dad onto the program. Period. Now, the second thing is when I get siblings, but especially mom or dad, and you know, over the years, my experience was maybe 75% moms, 25% dads. At Thornton, are you? How's your ratio, moms to dads?
Moms and dads, pretty equal, actually.
Well, so and there's another.
Yeah.
Right. Fixing, renewing them all at white belt, is another $40,000 a month revenue. Fixing, adding moms and dads is the difference between the active you're at now and 350. Mm-hmm. Right. So that's the push you way over a million, right?
I'm a little confused. Can you sort of break that down a little bit?
What I just said to her?
Yeah.
Oh, no, we're going back again.
No, I just want to
explain. I really only said two things very simple. Don't let the renewals die on the vine, because they get so busy doing enrollments, they forget to do renewals, and then they go do renewals, and right? Is if they just renew them all at white belt rather than waiting, and letting them die in the vine, that would dramatically improve their revenue.
And then you use a sale that the parents come free. Is that what you were saying too?
No.
No.
That's not what I'm saying.
Oh, okay.
No, but what I was saying is any child that you bring in for an introductory lesson, you should have mom and dad take the class with them. And then by having mom and dad take the introductory class with them, at least half of the kids you can enroll one or both parents. Right? So if I had a class where I enrolled 20 kids, I should have really 30 plus students in that class because at least half of them have one or both parents. Right? And again, what the part of the rationale in doing the enrollment is somebody's going to bring the kid twice a week anyway. You don't want them to sit on the bench with their cell phone. And play around on Candy Crush or Pokemon Go or whatever the hell the current thing is. Candy Crush, Pokemon Go, then was big. Then what's
Facebook?
What's
Facebook?
Putz around on Facebook. But what's the Pokemon Go replacement? What's everybody wasting their mental energy?
My parents are still doing Candy Crush.
Candy Crush. Okay, so it went back to Candy Crush. They had a brief window of Pokemon Go, and then they caught all the Pokemon or whatever the hell they are.
It just took for me, because I just did this recently, it just took inviting them. Just like you said, hey, why don't you take off your shoes and come on the mat with your kids so you can see what we do and how it works. This would be good. And if it's really, it's an easy upgrade to have them do that, because once they know that they have permission to do that, they want to do it.
Right. Well, and the biggest barrier is getting them on the floor the first time. Because an awful lot of them have this, I don't feel comfortable doing it. Which their kids have that feeling too, but the parent says, no, go do it. And then they sit on the bench, right? Leading by example.
Which is also an easy way to increase their retention.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's what I was going to say. Because once you get the parents involved, it improves the renewal rate and it improves the retention rate.
I found that even if they didn't enroll, they were more supportive of the whole program.
Yes.
Because they got their feet on the floor.
Yeah. Yeah, and it improves the overall atmosphere of the school, right? So, unequivocally, I could give you data proven is that the students where one or both parents are training, the more family members are trained, the less likely they are to drop out. I can tell you, over the years, we had a rapidly disproportionate number of families graduating to black belt than we had families that were enrolling to begin with, right? So it dramatically improves the retention rate. It also dramatically improves the environment and the feeling of the school, right? And it improves dramatically the renewal rate. Now, from a pricing standpoint, what I've ended up liking, and I'll give this credit to Bill Clark because he talked me into it, it took me a long time to come around to buying into it, is I like it's full price for one person or double full price for a family loan. Okay? And I agonized on
all
that
all the way through the leadership?
What's that?
All the way through leadership, so you can have 6 to 8 people and all their tests are covered and everything is covered in that program?
Yeah.
We're in Utah. We have
big families.
Well, yeah. The only place we do a testing fee is at black belt. Mm-hmm. And we do a single and a family option.
Okay, so you charge extra for the black belt test.
Right, but nowhere else.
Okay.
Right. Given my preference, I would never... Given my preference... I would charge them for enrollment, charge them for renewal, never charge them for anything else. Mm-hmm. So I would have everything included. I would never have them buy stuff. I would never have a testing fee. I would never have anything else, right? Mm-hmm. We had years ago solved part of that by putting in most good ideas come from outside of our little industry. And it, Jody, ex-wife number two, I was looking at her tuition bill went back to bachelor's degree and then master's. I was looking at her tuition bill, and they had all these things itemized out, but one of them was the activities pass. I was like, well, what's an activities pass? Well, they have a recreation center and a fitness center, one thing or another, so it's you're paying separately, you have no option, but you're paying separately to do that. And at the time, we weren't charging for tests, but we were charging for intramural tournaments. So every quarter, we were having an intramural tournament, we were charging for them, and then we'd have Jeff Smith or somebody come in, and we'd have a seminar, and we'd charge them for it. And I said, well, you know, the problem is, we're chasing them down to get them to pay $20, we're chasing them down to pay this, and you know, and like if you look at Stephen Covey, he talks about building the emotional bank account. And by the way, lawyers are the worst at this. I've never dealt with a law firm that would piss me off. Because, well, I mean,
I'm a different kind of attorney.
Well, I'm not talking about you, but you know, I mean, as soon as I get charged, you know, a dollar a page to make Xerox copies, and a dollar a page to send a fax, and the 3-minute phone conversation was 15 minutes because they bill 15-minute increments. I mean, you know, it's just all that kind of stuff. And where I finally came to that conclusion really wasn't that. It was I was staying at a comparable hotel with this. It's the Harbor Beach Marriott in Fort Lauderdale. And it's right on the beach like this, has a beautiful pool like this. But I was down there and I was paying $550 a night for a room that was, you know, comparable again to this property. But what, and it was, again, while I was doing the MBA, and I was down there, and I had my books, and I'd go to the pool, and I like to drink iced tea, so they'd order iced tea. And what I start paying attention to is, you picked up the phone in the room, it was 75 cents. You parked the car, it was $35. You used the safe in the room, it was $7 or $10 a night. And then the straw that broke the camel's back, as silly as it seems, is I was sitting at the pool for 8 hours reading. And I ordered an iced tea, it was $3. Every time they refilled it, it was $3, right? So now I'm paying $5.50 a night for the room, but the $15 for iced tea is the camel that broke, you know, the straw that broke camel's back. And then it dawned on me, is like, how many different ways do we do that, right? Is you know, a lot of schools, it's $10 for the patch. And then you have your first belt test, and it says X amount. And then you need these pads. And what we used to do was, you're a white belt, you need hand pads and mouthpiece, and you get paid for that. And then you're a gold belt, you need this, this, and this, you pay for that. And then you're, well, every time you ask them for money, it's the same level of emotional steam, right? The worst I've ever seen, by the way, was, I was, again, in Fort Lauderdale, and there was a school, and several others are down there watching, and we're watching the class, and all of a sudden, 40 kids come running over to mom or dad, mostly mom, like this. And we're watching this board breaking day. And so what they were doing is they're running over, and it was a dollar a board, and the kids are coming over, and one mom gives the kid $10, and he gets to break 10 boards, another one, mom gives the kid $3, another one, mom's creeping around her pocket, going over the desk, asking if she can give him a credit card, she says, she didn't have any cash, another one, no parents there, and they're in the corner crying. And what it was is, he took us in the back room and showed us his saw, and explained how he was making 75% profit per board, and how every month he made an extra $3,000 on boards. And I'm looking at it, and I've got, you know, there's two kids crying out there, and there's three kids that got to break 10 boards, and then I'm going, yeah, but you just pissed off a third of the room, and you irritated another third by having the kid come out like that, right? And so, I mean, the more you can get away from that.
And Master Oliver, I would point out, too, the other issue is we do all kinds of stuff like this all the time, where we spend a bunch of time.
Yeah.
He went to the store and bought the cheapest boards, and then he cut them. It wasn't like he, you know, paid 1 cent per board and they just got delivered. You have to think about it. He probably spent 5 hours a month screwing around.
Or I was back in the back cutting them. He had a saw back there. And sooner or later, he's going to have an employee cut their finger off. And, you know, I mean, for God's sake.
Yeah, forget even that, but I mean, just the labor. Just the labor of doing that. And, you know, a lot of times you say, well, yeah, but it doesn't take as much time. That's like people doing their billing themselves. But it doesn't take much time. Any of that stuff.
Right.
Outsource as much as you can and don't start creating those
companies. But again, we were back over here. Was, you know, on the little kids class, the way you implement it is you don't do anything different. You just mark it to kids down to that age. The ones who aren't capable of paying attention and focusing without slowing down their own learning and being a distraction in class, they go into a preparatory class called whatever the hell you want to call it. Right?
And is it typically a shorter class?
Yeah, typically. Okay. Yeah. Typically it'd be the their 30 minutes and the regular class is 45 minutes. Because part of the biggest problem is just their attention span. Right.
That might be worth just putting on our list that we could go over curriculum design for that. You know, it's pretty safe.
But really, the curriculum design is just stretch out what you're doing a little bit longer.
Teach
them smaller chunks. What's that?
Yeah, charge the same though.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, do the same enrollment.
Yeah.
You don't have a different enrollment for those
same
people. It's just the same enrollment and the conversation. You know, and by the way, the script. Now, Ms. White, you know what happens is some parents look at their 3 or 4 year old and they think that they're a little too young for this. The reality is it's just that the learning curve of the younger kids is a little bit different. What happens is the ones that start when they're 4 or 5 years old actually end up much better. But what you're going to see physically is the learning curve kind of looks like this and then it goes like this, where a little bit older child is, it looks like, you know, it looks like that. And an adult, it may look like that, right? So.
Is it harder to retain those little guys?
No.
Okay.
Easier.
Yeah, easier.
That's not what we've experienced, but that's
well, you're doing it wrong.
That's what happens with a lot of this stuff. We tell you guys a lot of things and you know, like do this or do that or do birthday parties, do whatever. Well, that doesn't work for us, or that doesn't work. Okay, yeah.
Is it,
you missed the 5 or 10% that you didn't do right.
Is it harder to keep kindergartners excited about school or high school kids? There you go. Kindergartners?
Yeah, kindergartners, it's easy to keep excited.
Oh,
about
right. Yeah. We're saying the same thing, right? Yeah. But the explanation is, keep in mind that the younger they start, I mean, just think about learning foreign language. Think about so many other skills. Is the younger they start, the less barriers they have to learning, the less preconceptions they have about it. But the less they know left from right, and the less, you know, control they have over their own body. So it's going to take a while for their body to catch up to their ability to absorb it mentally. And then it'll start showing by they'll be much better. Right? And, you know, it's funny, the people who, you know, when I started, I was like the only kid. And, you know, people used to say, well, you know, I don't want to teach kids. You know, I mean, I want people who are really good, but, you know, in every sport, the ones who are really good are the ones that started young. You know, there's not a lot of professional football players who started when they were 19. There's not a lot of Muhammad Ali's who started boxing when they were 20. You know, there's not, I mean, hell, gymnasts are washed up by the time they're 17, right? So that rationale is completely ass backwards, right? You know, if you want really good fighters or you want really good students, you want to start them young, right? The issue is you got to keep them long enough to get there. Does that make sense? So you had a question a long time ago.
Oh, yeah. I was just going to go back to talking about the whole process and how you deal with kids coming from other schools, other martial arts schools. And
right.
Trying to reculturize them, I guess you could say.
Sure. Well, you know, it's an interesting question. Do you get much of that?
Quite a few.
Do you?
What does quite a few look
like? Well, I mean, I take that back. I mean, a few, but I was always kind of not really knowing exactly what to do. Oh, gosh.
Sure.
What do I do with this guy? And so, or where they are in their stage as far as are they more of a beginner, more of an intermediate or advanced type kid? What do I do with this?
So I
that type of question, you know, like, I do this?
I almost always just start them from scratch, and then let them move as rapidly as is possible for them. Okay, so I rarely ever take somebody who's a brown belt somewhere and put them in the brown belt class, because that is a disaster. I almost always put them in the white belt class and say, now here's the deal. I know you were a brown belt there. What the curriculum is different. What the, you know, the way we think. Things are different. If in 5 weeks you can be back to where you were physically and everything else as a brown belt, that's fine. And if it takes 2-3 years like it would anybody else, that's fine too. But what we're going to do is start at the beginning and work your way up through, right? And then what happens is some of them don't want to do that, which is fine. You don't want them anyway. Over the years with staff, same deal. I mean, if I ever brought if I ever hired somebody, which I was loath to do, but if I ever hired somebody who was already a black belt somewhere else, I made them start completely over and train up through. And if they had too much ego to do that, it was a good indication I didn't want them to begin with. Right? So.
Yeah, I would add something onto that. What ends up happening is with a lot of the, they're from another school and they come to you. They come to you a lot of times because they don't like the other guy, unless it's they moved.
Yeah.
But a lot of times they don't like the other guy and they come to you. Well, what I've found is that they don't like the other guy, but they really want your system to be exactly like they were used to.
Mm-hmm.
So when we start them in that, no matter what we do at the beginning, whatever we start, they're a pain.
Mm-hmm.
They're a pain.
Well,
so,
let's add to that, though. They left because they didn't like the other guy. But 90% of the time, the problem was them, not the other guy.
Right.
And you're now going to be the next problem.
Yeah.
I almost always, if they were advanced at all, I tried to send them back.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's an important point. I do that too. And you know, the ATA's got a lot of schools in my town. So I would always get the guys that were mad at their instructor. And most instructors, when somebody comes in, I come in and say, oh, you know, I didn't like the other guy, so can you take me? They get a big ego and go, well, I must be better than them. See, that's what y'all kind of can do. And again, it's not you better than
the other guy. You're going to be the next instructor.
Yeah, you're going to be the other one that was the jerk.
Back when I was foolishly exposing our students to lots of open tournaments, what would tend to happen is our top people were among the best there almost always. Greg and Harrison can attest to this clearly. Call me on bullshit if I'm calling bullshit. And what we would have is the other guys trying to do competition teams were always trying to take our guys. Now, I never understood what pride there is in just putting your uniform top on my guy and having the winning team, right? And our staff was always worried about that when we'd lose somebody. I said, no, it's like the wolf with a deer herd. They eat the sick ones and get the sick ones out before they poison anybody else, right? And really, the person you have that quits in a huff and goes to the guy down the street, the problem is usually, now, there are certainly situations where you have a staff member whose service delivery is screwed up. There's certainly times that you need service delivery recovery. There's certainly times that you were in a bad mood and you were an asshole and you need to fix that, right? But most of the time, it's not the school they came from, it's them, right? And I don't want his problem people, right? I used to joke about it. I said, well, if we could just figure out who they were beforehand, we could just kick them out. You know, we could. And I've done that, by the way, before. I've fired people en masse, and the script is really easy. Marty, I really want to apologize. I'm so sorry that we haven't done a great job for you. I took the opportunity to put a list of schools that you might like a lot better. They might fit better. I would really recommend the asshole that I would really recommend this guy. I've taken liberty making sure that your agreement has been canceled and we refunded that last payment. But I mean, that's the script, right? So I take full responsibility because I don't want to give him any other reason to be mad at me. And then, you know, you're out of here.
I copied that from you, did that this year, and found that the other parents who actually stick with you are very appreciative of the fact that you just got to get that group out.
A lot of this, though, in dealing with all our students is making sure we have really clear rules from the get-go. So if somebody comes from another style, or maybe they moved. I mean, that's another scenario. They moved, and, you know, I'm Phoenix, so a lot of people moved to Phoenix. So we get people coming to us, and they moved to us, and they were nice, and we started. But I always, if they came from another style, it's very important to anybody, really, not even new students. I mean, we have a policies and procedures we go through, and you guys have seen that on the Facebook page. And we go through everything that's happened. This is when we're going to communicate with you. In fact, we try to do that with you guys too. This is how we communicate. This is we don't send us a Facebook message, you know, those kind of things. So all those things that we want to communicate, we put on a list and we make sure that we're really consistent with the rules. So that kind of goes with these guys. Okay, you know, you want to be here. This is what the rules are. If you're starting a white belt, this is how it's going to go. Then it's not a negotiation. A lot of times, I've been in those meetings when I first started out where it was the mom and the dad and the two kids, and they're trying to have this interview with me. And I'm like, there ain't no interview with me. This is my kingdom, and you guys will see if we let you.
Right.
And that's how all this should go. Mm-hmm. And then your life will be a lot easier.
Yeah. Thomas?
I just had a quick question, yes or no answer.
No.
Are you all charging? You know the question.
Does that I don't know. The,
are you... charge, are the Mile High schools or the other schools charging midterm fees for black belts? Like when they midterm towards their next
round? We're not midterm.
I know what you're asking. We're charging them for the major test.
That's it. Right?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
But you would.
Amanda, you want to clarify that one?
We do have a charge for our midterm tests. It's really stupid.
Yeah.
Every couple months.
For the black belt midterms?
Yes, yeah, so we're doing the same thing.
I think that's what he's referring to.
And I'm thinking about
midterms.
Getting rid of it.
Yeah, I'm not sure we're on the same page, but.
Because I'm thinking of every 6 months we have major tests, and then every 2 months we have our less. Like,
yeah, it should really just be the major.
Less time ones.
Yeah. So everybody should not charge for tests.
That's what he did say.
Well, actually, when I said that, I said we have a fee for the black belt test, not for the under black belt test.
But if you've been to their black belt tests, it's a big deal. Like the last one's up in Breckenridge, and it's an elaborate
retreat. And it really was, we backed into it because there was so much expense. One, it's a multi-school issue, and it's a franchise issue and everything else. But there was so much expense on the retreat and bringing other people in and so forth that we ended up with a fee for those.
It's like 3 days.
Yeah.
So anybody who's saying, like, Master Oliver students or my students, we get the other thing, oh, you guys are a belt factory, you're this. I mean, they went through 3 days of, like, hell to get their black belts. And anybody that would go there is full of crap. And they're very
they went through hell in a nice place.
Yeah, and I got to teach them. I taught them for, like, an hour and a half, and then they said they wanted to learn more, right? And I was uneasy.
Who here was at the Breckenridge test?
They just loved it.
Okay, what was that, an easy test or a difficult test?
Difficult.
We were in it.
Okay, you were in it. You don't count. That's a subjective evaluation. Colby, describe what the testing was like.
I just started a leadership program in my school, and really a big part of that, the big push to that, was after coming from Breckenridge, because I was so impressed by the black belt test that, I mean, the quality level of the students testing there was phenomenal, right? I thought it was awesome. So, yeah, definitely not an easy test
at all. These things go together. Yeah. You can't disconnect them. Like, yeah, we'll charge them higher prices for longer term, all this stuff's happening, but it's also to generate better quality in the end. I mean, They're not one or the other, you know. And I remember hearing.
Let's make sure we got to all of the questions. Yes.
About 2 hours back.
Here. Right. Yeah. Well, yeah, we had like seven.
So
it was about.
Talking about renewal, you said, you know, we have a white belt prize,
right.
Saves you $10,000.
Right.
They say no to
right.
you at that point.
Yeah.
When so now 2 months later, you're going to sit down with them
right.
again.
Not 2 months later.
Okay,
we're talking to them a lot.
They're in the next cycle. And
now they're the next price up.
Right.
So when did you tell them that there would be this next price up?
Well, you know, Ms. Jones, as we talked about before, you know, really, you know, we would have liked to have made the decision at White Belt, which is significantly discounted tuition level. At White Belt. We can't honor that at this point.
Okay.
However,
this is when they're agreeing with Gold Belt.
Yeah. However, rather than doing the full tuition, we'll still give you a discount. Right.
Okay.
And then I can describe what that was.
Yeah.
And a lot of times they'll say, but you told me it was
yeah.
it was $397. Yeah, it certainly would have been that by White Belt. You know, we'll give you a significantly discounted tuition now. Then I'm going to be $447.
Okay.
But can't I have that? Fair warning, I told you when it expired, right? Mm-hmm. And the only way you can not do that and maintain integrity is I just didn't talk to them to begin with and didn't give them a deadline. And then I have to take responsibility. I'm so sorry, it's my fault, we didn't get a chance to.
Yeah.
And there is a significant discount at White Belt. I'll go ahead and honor that as long as we, right?
Yeah.
See, I don't want to say, well, you didn't do it by then, but, you know, I'll be nice and go ahead. See, if you do that.
Yeah.
Then you've undermined yourself.
Yeah, and then any time else you say, you can only do this.
Well, then they might as well wait until the next belt.
Yeah.
Right. If you gave him the lower price now, then okay, yeah, you know what, I'll think about that. After he gets his next belt, then I'll do it. No, you can't do that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay. But there were several more questions we never got around to earlier. Harrison?
My question is about in the website, I feel like there's a lot of videos.
There are.
Of live talks and things. I was kind of looking for more scripts of like a list of objections and how to deal with them, because I'm still really bad at that.
Sure.
And the sales process.
here's part of our behind the curtain conversation yesterday. Well, should we even record these live events?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Well, no, wait a minute. Because there could be two levels of it. There could be, you do an audio and everybody who came get the audio. You do an audio and video and everybody who came got the audio and video. Or you can do what we're doing now, is there's an audio video, there's all the handouts, you didn't show up, we put them up on the website, and then a lot of people justify not showing up because they're going to have the recordings. But the recordings aren't exactly well organized. So do we go back and we do them in chunks and we do a PowerPoint and we make it an online learning, and if so, why even have a live meet? Right? Now, who's been to at least 5 or 6 live events? Can you replace showing up live?
No.
See? Because what our debate behind the scenes is more about how the hell do we get everybody to show up? Because truthfully, when you're here, an awful lot of you are going to have a much brighter aha having lunch or dinner with somebody else in here, having a hallway conversation than you did sitting in the room. Others are going to have a much brighter aha by sitting down one-on-one with Master Smith or Master Moody or something like that and kind of talking about your situation than you're going to have in the room. And others, it's going to be the synergy of 2 or 3 of those pieces, right? And for others, it's going to be a much brighter aha because instead of like watching a video of me saying something, you heard Colby say, or you heard me say in Hymn Valley, whatever, 180, 150, 150, and then 200. And all of a sudden, instead of that being like bullshit, that's like, holy crap, really? Right? I mean, there's, you know, there's that transition point, right? Would everybody agree with that statement?
Yeah.
See, there's that point at which you get rid of all of the excuses you have. And by the way, don't anybody take this wrong. It's certainly not directed at Colby. I've done this type of mastermind meetings and stuff. I've probably every year spent $100,000 to $250,000 on my own training and, you know, read 1 or 2 books a week or more and everything else. And every time I've sat down in this kind of mastermind meeting, my reaction almost always is the guy across from me who's doing twice the net isn't as smart as me and doesn't have a better business than I do and isn't in a better location. But having that reaction, and anybody who's doing really well in here, anybody who's doing over $1 million a year, it doesn't take much sitting down and talking to them to conclude. It's not because they graduated from Harvard and the family had a multi-million-dollar fortune they bequested to them, and it's not because they're in the best location in Manhattan.
It's not because they're a black belt or a world champion or something.
Yeah, exactly. And by the way, Grandmaster Smith, who ran to the airport, I mean, he legitimately is world champion and legitimately is the person with the most watched fight in history. And guess what? Most of the other people who had even a comparable record never learned how to run the business side. They didn't end up with a career doing this. That wasn't the piece. Right? My funniest story is when I moved to Washington, D.C. from Tulsa, Oklahoma, I hadn't gotten this in my head yet. I was a student at Georgetown, but I was running a branch. And when I first moved there, I stayed at his house out in Olney, Maryland. He had this big house and the Mercedes, one thing or another. But he had all these trophies. He had the Bruce Lee trophy and all these grand championship trophies, and they were all like sitting in the basement, kind of half wilting with dust on them. And I said, in the school they were had me managing, had this big display window. And it had this big display thing. I said, well, it's a shame for all those to go to waste. And I thought that was really cool. And now he's a world champ. And so I went and dusted them all, and I tightened them together. And one by one, I transported them down to the school. And I put them in the window, and I made this big display. You know what it did for the school? I had exactly over 1.5 years, one guy who walked in thought we were a trophy shop. That was